Welcome to this webinar organized by the IRIS and Positive European Projects. The topic is how software numerical tools support the creation of replication plans in smart cities energy projects. In the first part, Nikos Nikolopoulos from CERTH will present a case study from the IRIS Fowler City Alexandroupolis. Nikos and his colleagues will demonstrate software tools that can be used for the evaluation of replication strategies for near zero energy districts. In the second part of the webinar, Christian Kane from EPF will present a case study from the Irish Lighthouse City in East Côte d'Azur. In particular, he will demonstrate how the software tools are used for the battery sizing in the IMRED building. After the presentation, we will have time for questions and discussion. I give the floor to Nikos with the first presentation.
Okay, thank you very much, Panagiotis. So good morning also from my side.
Oh, sorry.
Hello.
Okay. So just to give you a short background, CERTH is acting as technical coordinator in these two projects, Smart Cities Related, IRIS and Positive. And more or less the idea is to try and share with you, let's say, the know-how and ideas we have when related to the replication activities. As you know, the structure of the Smart Cities projects deals with having some lighthouse cities who demonstrate solutions in order to become self-sustainable, even energy positive. And there is a group also of fellow cities who try to replicate some of these solutions in their territory, aiming to the same goal. In that respect, as part of the IRIS project, Alexandroupolis City is one of the fellow cities, having Nice, Côte d'Azur, Utrecht, and Göteborg as lighthouse cities. And the aim is to check how some of these solutions to be demonstrated in the lighthouse cities can be replicated on the territory of Alexandroupolis. In that respect, I take the initiative to say that I may be the main presenter, but this work has been undertaken by multiple persons within CERTH, also in collaboration with Alexandroupolis ecosystem, which means the municipality, as well as Energy Hive, which is an organization who supports Alexandroupolis on a local level. So I will start with the presentation, and then I will be giving also the floor to some colleagues who contributed in that, and for whom I would like to thank. In the end, there will be also a presentation by Christian Kain from EDF, dealing specifically with software that they use within EDF for battery sizing in the case of two buildings who aim at self-consumption operation level. So to start with,
Nikos, yes. Sorry to interrupt you. Can you please make the presentation full screen? It's better for the recording. Okay, thanks.
Do you see that?
Yes, yes, fine.
Okay, thank you. So, as I told you, I briefly described the aim and the objectives of this presentation and webinar. We will start with a short description of the replication activities for Alexandroupolis, which fall under the transition track number one, which in our case deals with transforming current existing building stock into energy efficient or even energy positive. We will have one slide dealing with software selection, so available tools in the open literature that can be used for supporting replication activities, so dimensioning in reality of systems and feasibility studies. We will proceed with a detailed description and presentation of the case studies analysis, ending with the evaluation of the numerical results and some lessons learned. And as I told you, we will end this webinar with the case of embedded sourcing by Christian Kaim, mainly to have a look also on the commercial tools that big companies like EDF use for studying such cases. So in order to speed up the process, a key question always deals with what does a replication activity include. And from our perspective, more or less it is a feasibility study. That means that we need to have in the end some dimensions, some design specifications that can be mature enough in order to lead as well to tendering. And at least for the case of Alexandroupolis, this is considered to be very important because it will help them in the near future to make public procurements aiming at actually implementing these solutions. And in that respect, we decided internally to use some available software tools that aim towards this direction. And first we had, let's say, a screening of available tools in the open literature that can support such type of activities. The axis upon which this evaluation is made is first of all an energetic one, but we should consider as well environmental impacts and as well financial aspects. So for example, what can be the payback period of the solutions to be included, considering that someone will invest on that. So just a short description of Alexandroupolis is a city located in northern eastern Greece, close to the border with Turkey. They have already validated SEAP, and SECAP is member of the Covenant of Mayors and is a founding member of Greek Green Cities Network. And that's part of their plans is to become sustainable and an innovation hub, considering as well the TAP, which is the pipeline dealing with natural gas, to feed as well the whole Europe. And their aim as part of their SEAP is to reduce the emissions by 20% with a vision up to this year, which as you may know, will need to be updated for all European countries with a vision up to 2030 or even 2015. Just to give you the short background, in Iris project we have defined actually five transition tracks, and under the transition track number one, which deals with energy retrofit of buildings, we have two solutions oriented to the case of building level. One has to do with the retrofit solutions of individual buildings to become energy positive, to become energy efficient, even if even energy positive. And another use case has to do with the setup of a new built neighborhood. While solution 1.2 under the same transition track deals and goes up to the level of the district. So from the building level to the district level. The buildings that have been selected to act as guidance for the replication activities include, let's say, three nursery schools, the senior citizen community center, and some office buildings. As you can see, we don't have in this case any residential building, but mainly tertiary one. And their location is depicted in the let's say map that you see here. So they are quite spread, so they cannot be considered to be part of a district, but on as individual assets. So Kostas Liberopoulos, if you can also present some details about the selection of the districts and buildings for the case of Alexandroupolis.
Yes, of course. Good morning to everyone. This is Kostas Liberopoulos. I am the site manager for IRIS project regarding the replication activities in Alexandroupolis city. I would like to start by saying that, as Nico said, we have signed the Covenant of Mayors and our target was 20% until 2020. I'm happy to say that there was a recent municipal decision to update this target for 40% until 2030. So we signed the new Covenant of Mayors, the updated Covenant of Mayors. So to begin, to start with the buildings, you saw the previous slide that Nikos presented is about seven buildings of that are owned by the municipality. These buildings have already been renovated regarding energy, meaning that they have installed renewable energy systems from another project. And this was the base case in order to make them positive. That's why we chose these buildings, the seven buildings. Regarding the second slide that you see now on the screen is a new area that was introduced in the city. It's not built yet, so that's why we decided to investigate the feasibility of developing a new district with positive energy buildings. This is what we studied here. Nikos, can you please forward the slide? Nikos?
Yes, Kostas, I'm trying.
Okay. And the replication of the second solution of IRIS project regards the retrofitting of an existing district of buildings. For this solution, we chose a social housing district. This was buildings developed for social housing, now are privately owned from citizens of Alexandroupolis, but it is important to say that these buildings can be found very often in Greece regarding the current situation of these buildings. All buildings are built between 1970 and 1980, so this means that they are unisolated because there was any regulation at that time in Greece. And so that's why we selected these buildings. It's a district that can be, or we're trying to see how it can be a near zero energy district, replicating solutions that have been demonstrated or will be demonstrated within IRIS project. Next slide, please. And here you can see the technologies that we selected to replicate, to investigate their feasibility in these three case studies as described. You can see that we have the insulation, of course, photovoltaics, batteries for electrical storage, district heating and cooling using ground source heat pumps, and other technologies for achieving the target of either positive energy buildings, either near zero energy districts.
I think yes. In that respect, considering that, as you may see, there are varying solutions that should fit different use cases. The main problem we needed in the beginning to face was the selection of the various tools that we will use for conducting this type of feasibility studies. And in that respect, we select a range of selection criteria upon which we made our final decisions, the most important of which were, let's say, whatever tool is selected to be in position to model as many as possible technologies from those that we have selected. Another thing has to do with the cost effectiveness. That means that we prefer to have tools that more or less are not accompanied by any licensing fee, so they are open software. A very key factor is related to the easiness of use. That means that in this type of replication studies, we should not expect that always these are conducted by experienced users with a deep background in modeling tools. In that sense, we need to select tools that can be easy, user-friendly, and can be at least on a first level be used by non-experienced and non-experts. In that sense, we made a literature survey, and in the next slide we will present what we have identified in the open literature, while the next range of criteria deal with the ability of these tools to provide simplified outputs and to require at the same time simplified inputs. So the level of detail is not very deep, unless someone needs for any specific reason to have this requirement, while the tool needs to provide as many as possible performance evaluation parameters like technical, financial, environmental, as we told you. So in this slide, you may see variable tools that exist and are used for this type of analysis, either on a building or on a district level, dealing mainly with energy aspects. Most of them are well known, and we, let's say, try to categorize them with presenting their key features. And in our case, we have selected actually red screen and energy plan. Red screen is a tool that has already some databases for across at least Europe, which can provide data about environmental conditions, so temperature, humidity levels, or solar irradiance. So this is quite a good tool, easy to use, but mainly oriented to the case of single building levels. So with this type of tool, one can examine as well scenarios like those of the districts, but from our perspective, does not meet this type of requirements as in the case of building level simulations. And for that reason, we have selected energy plan. And a key issue for this type of software solutions deals with the interoperability of these tools and how the output of one tool can be used as an input in the other tool. So keeping that as well as a selection criteria, we selected these two tools since the output of red screen from the building level can be used as an input to the energy plan for the district levels. And the good thing for both tools is that they combine several renewable technologies like photovoltaics or batteries, but also heating and cooling systems. So to start with, we will give a short overview of the steady state simulations representing all three main energy vectors, electricity, heating and cooling. While we will, as a next step, we will proceed with the case of non-steady simulations. And this mainly deals with electricity and heating, electricity flexibility, voltage and frequency control, mainly on the electricity level, but also its integration with the other rest of networks, like heating or cooling. So a typical example deals with the case of a power to heat concept, where an excess of electricity can be used for through the use of heat pumps for providing as well heating or cooling. So, Vasilis, may you start giving a short overview of red screen?
Yes, hello, thank you, Nikos. Hello, everyone. My name is Vasilis and I work with Serge Perry. As Nikos mentioned, we used the red screen for the building level analysis, and then the input from that was used in energy plan for the district level analysis. So red screen is a quite well-known software for pre-feasibility studies. It's provide simplified technical modeling for a range of technologies for power heating and cooling. It is a simulation tool, but it can be used for other purposes as well, for performance analysis of existing projects. And it also includes extensive databases for various technologies, so that was used. That was a great benefit in order to simplify the simulation process. It provides fast results, so you can try very different configurations, different systems, and then get an easy result in terms of the technical performance and the financial or environmental performance. It is user-friendly and has extensive financial and sensitivity and risk analysis capabilities as well, apart from the technical side. And it has, there are quite a lot of tutorials online where you can get some easy training, and also tutorials on the included in the software, so the user can train themselves. And it's cost-effective, so there's at the moment you get the annual fee for 10 PCs for a price of 600 euros approximately, or even free distribution for academic and research institutes. So if you would like to move to the next slide, Nikos. And then for the district analysis, energy plan was used. The energy plan is a software that was used to analyze energy, environmental, and economic impact for large national and regional energy systems. It simulates the operation of a system of energy system on an hourly basis, and it includes the electricity, heating components, cooling components, industry, and transport sectors. Again, it is user-friendly, it is deterministic in nature, which means that how many times you run the model, you get the same result. It's not stochastic. It has a fast comparison of different scenarios, so it allows for fast comparison of different scenarios, so the analysis is done quite fast. And quite an important bit is that it has a freeware distribution. And again, there's available online training. There are available resources where the user can train themselves. Can we move to the next slide? Yeah, so again, it was mentioned earlier, we used the simulation procedure that we used is for the building level. We considered, we used red screen where the inputs are include factors such as the climate, the internal conditions, the building fabric and systems, and some renewable energy production. And then the output of the software is the heating requirements on an annual basis, the cooling requirements, and the electricity load of a house, of a building, as well as the energy production from the system, and then the emissions reduction. And in addition, the user can also do financial analysis and emissions analysis. And then for the district part, where we had to simulate the district, with the output of red screen, which is the heating and cooling and electricity requirements, were used as an aggregate for all the buildings of that district. We used this input in the energy plan software, which provided the aggregated energy balances for the whole district. A great deal of information was required to collect before the analysis was conducted. The vast majority of that information is information collected on site in order to map the local condition and the context, which is the core information required on the preliminary analysis for this project. And then this was used to develop the model based on the local context, and then some information about the systems and the buildings was collected from relative literature, from the software databases, which were really helpful in the analysis. There were information from partners. We get feedback from partners adjusted to the site localities, as well as expert feedback from previous projects and local partners in the area of Alexandroupolis.
Yeah, thank you, Vasilis. In that respect, what we need to emphasize is that the role of the local municipality is a key aspect in this type of replication activity. So in that respect, there needs to be a strong collaboration almost day to day between the partner who develops these replication activities on the level of design and dimensioning with the local stakeholders who need to provide a relatively extensive data for conducting them. So, Kostas, can you share with us your experience?
Yes, Nikos, thank you. What we did in Alexandroupolis regarding the transition track one, as we say in Irish, and regarding the collection of the required data, is that we followed a two-stage approach. The first stage is a broader approach that includes the assessment of the city needs and the challenges, the policy context analysis.
Kostas, excuse me, Kostas, sorry to interrupt you. Please, everyone that can't, should mute your his microphone if he's not speaking or she's not speaking because there is a lot of noise.
I think it's Vasily. Vasily's okay. So, as I said, we followed the two-stage approach. The first stage is a broader approach that includes the assessment of the city needs and challenges, the policy context, and the stakeholder analysis. We investigated the Sustainable Energy Action Plan of the city, the technical program, the operational program. We discussed with the stakeholders that we found that are relative to these solutions that we are investigating. Of course, we did a very good and a thorough read of the solutions to be replicated from the partners, the lighthouse cities, from the other partners of IRIS, and we then concluded to the ours, as we say in IRIS, the replication, what we are interested in regarding the demonstrated solutions. And then having in mind the local context, we decided some indicative case studies for replicating these solutions. Nikos, please, the next slide. And the second stage is more specific, and it refers to the actual collection of the data that are required to make the feasibility studies. That is to say, the data that are required from the two software tools that we selected with CERF to be used for the feasibility studies. So in collaboration with CERF, we started collecting the required data, and this data were collected through collaboration with the technical department of the municipality. I have to say that the really important and helpful was the collaboration with local technical experts from our partner in IRIS, the Energy Hive cluster, which is a cluster of engineering companies here in Alexandroupolis. So they have really good information regarding the feasibility of several solutions in energy retrofitting and renewable energy integration on buildings. So this information was available in order to assess the replicability of the solutions that are demonstrated in other lighthouse cities. And also some information was collected from the local academic organization, which is Democritus University of Thrace, regarding some efficiency numbers and some more scientific questions and queries that we have on these solutions. Nikos, I think you may proceed.
Yeah, so more or less, as we told you, we needed to gather various type of data, either from experienced and local partners there, And a key aspect that we needed to include as well in collaboration also with the Lighthouse cities, at least for the innovative systems, is to have some cost estimations of the various systems in order to proceed with the business models and cost-benefit analysis. While, as we told you, online databases and literature data are always helpful toward this scope. And the third pillar of availability of data deals with what already this type of tools have in their databases. So, as we told you, we already presented red screen mainly compares to different scenarios. One day is entitled as base case, so more or less depicts, reflects the current status of the building. And another one, entitled as proposed case, has to do with the inclusion of the various system and their comparison. Towards this aim, we will, in the next slides, present you more or less the structure and some snapshots from this tool in order to have a more elaborated view on what it offers and how it operates. We will start with presenting you the type of input data we use, how we include them within the software, how we define the use cases, and we will end up with some indicative results. So, Vasilis, if you can start.
Yes, hello. As mentioned earlier, there are several information that we need to include. We start off with some basic information required for the analysis. So this is the weather data and the internal conditions inside the building. The climate data that we used is for the city of Alexandroupolis, and it was red screen includes extensive climate databases, which you can use. Also, alternatively, the user may include their own climate data if they find them more appropriate. And the data is in terms of temperature, humidity, solar radiation level, and heating and cooling degree days. In order to define the internal conditions, again, the input is quite simple. We consider the schedule of the house of the building that's used, the occupancy schedule. We consider the internal conditions, the thermostat setting for heating and cooling, and in this case we used some reasonable commonly used temperatures of 21 degrees for space heating and 25 degrees for the cooling season. And again, another information that is used is the changeover temperature. So this is the external temperature when the software considers that heating is no longer required, and then above that temperature the cooling is required. So a change over temperature from heating to cooling to 18 degrees we used in this case. So we start off with quite simplified input for the software. So if we move on the next slide. And then having defined this basic information, the next step is to define the equipment characteristics for providing heating and cooling. The input required again is quite simplified. So the user defines the fuel that is going to be used and the seasonal efficiency of the equipment. And that is used for when calculating the emissions analysis and the financial analysis. In this case, we consider the district heating. So this case study is about the building of the positive energy district that we saw earlier, which was a district of 100 houses. That has a district cooling network, heating and cooling network with geothermal heat pump. So in this case, we consider the district heating and cooling. And this information that we saw here is just indicative. The analysis was done in energy plan later on for the district and heating and cooling. So if we move on the next slide. So, so having defined the basic information for the simulation and then the information on the heating and cooling system, Then this is the biggest part of the red screen analysis, where we define the energy consumption components and the energy production components. So in a building, the energy consumption components are the losses due to the building fabric. And then there's the heat, the energy consumption from appliances that are used, from lighting and hot water. And we start off with defining the parameters of the building in order to calculate the building envelope energy requirements. So to do that, we use some information on the building geometry, the orientation, the thermophysical properties of the building elements, such as the U values for walls, windows, roof and floor, the solar heat gain coefficient of windows, the shading factor of the windows, and the infiltration of the building envelope. And then the output of the software, considering the climate as well, is the fabric heating and cooling load, as well as the energy saved if we were considering a retrofit scenario, which is not the case here, because we're looking at a new built dwelling, where basically the base case and the proposed case are the same. So the information required for the building fabric analysis, for the building fabric energy requirements, is quite common used in such calculations. And what we did, we used basically the information from the National Technical Guidelines on Energy Assessments. But then this should be readily available in every country on the national on the guidelines. Alternatively, for in order to do a fast analysis, or if this information is not provided, then RedScreen databases, RedScreen has databases and recommended values for most of these parameters. And then, having defined the energy requirements of the building fabric, we then proceed with calculating the energy requirements for lighting and cooling. Again, it's quite simplified information that's required. It's the in the case of lights, what we need to input is the energy required, the load for lights, which is the lighting load per unit area, the floor area of the building, and the number of hours that the lights are used. And then with this simple information, the software will calculate the annual electricity requirements for lighting. And on top of the electricity requirements, we will also calculate the effect of these heat gains on the heating and cooling load. And the same applies for the electrical appliances. So the user here enters some information on the typical appliances that are used in a house, such as computer, dishwasher, TV, etc. The number of hours and the nominal that these appliances are used, and the nominal power of these appliances. And then the software will calculate the annual electricity consumption, and also the effect of these appliances as heat gains on the space heating and cooling load. If we can move on to the next slide, please. Yeah, thank you. And then the next step is to calculate the solar hot water, the hot water consumption. And to do so, the software has an embedded algorithm where the required input is the daily hot water use in liters per day, and then the desired temperature of water. Of the hot water, as well as the supply temperature throughout the year as a minimum and maximum. And then with the algorithm, we will calculate the annual energy consumption for hot water. And again, the information here was provided from national technical guidelines, but then if these are not available, RedScreen has several recommended values, so the user can do a good approximation analysis. We move on to the next slide, please. So these were the basic energy consumption components. And then the software gives the option of including some energy production technologies as well. In terms of electricity, it has the option of building integrated PV or wind turbines, or even generic green energy sources. You can also consider some solar thermal for hot water, or solar air heaters for space heating. And this would then consider in the energy balance and how they would reduce the energy requirements of the building. And in our case, a PV system was considered, where the level of information is the capacity of the PV system, and then the typical losses from the cables and the system, as well as the inverter efficiency and stuff like that. So if we can move on the next slide, RESGRID would then take into account all this information that we used for the energy consumption and the energy production, and provide the results of for the energy balance for the building. And the results are presented for the space heating requirements, space cooling requirements, as well as the electricity consumption for lights and the electrical appliances, and the consumption for energy consumption for hot water. It also has the option to provide a simplified, simple payback period for each measure. So as was discussed earlier, when we model in RESGRID a retrofit scenario, which was not the case here, the user had the option to include a retrofit measure, and then there was the option to include a cost on that. And based on that cost, the software can calculate a simple payback period for each one of these measures. And then the user can, in this page here, you can click or you can select or deselect the measure and see how it changes the simple payback period of the whole investment, or even what's the payback period for that particular measure. So that provides a fast estimation of the contribution of each measure on the whole strategy. And that concludes basically the analysis for the building level. And then for the district level, we use the energy plan, which in general it is used to model much larger systems. So it's for national and regional energy systems. But we found it useful with minor data manipulation and structuring to conduct a technical evaluation of the district scale, which is a smaller one. So again, the procedure follows the same structure. So we first define the energy demands of the district, then we define the energy supply system, and in the end we consider the system balancing and storage to get the results. So the inputs are for the heating, for the energy demands, the inputs are in the form of an annual value and an hourly distribution profile. As mentioned earlier, we did the analysis in RESGRID, we get the annual values for heating, cooling and electricity. And then this was for one building, and then we multiply that times the number of buildings and we get the district level energy requirement. So this is the input from RESGRID. And in order to conduct the analysis, we were then required to develop the hourly profiles for the electricity demand, heating, cooling demand, and the PV production. If we can move on the next slide, please. Yeah, thank you. So this is the layout for the electricity demand. We have, all we need to do is to include the electricity demand, which was from RESGRID, and then the distribution profile, which is a TXT file that we developed. And the electricity demand profile was developed based considering the electricity, the appliances schedule and the lighting schedule that we considered in RESGRID. We created a typical profile, daily profile for winter and summer, and that was then constructed for the whole year based on winter and summer scenarios. Right, so that was the electricity demand distribution profile. We also had to do the heating and cooling demand profiles, and for that, all we had was the annual value from RESGRID. In order to do so, we used the heating and cooling degree days method. So we found the weather data in hourly format and choose an appropriate base temperature for calculating the heating degree days and cooling degree days, and that provided the distribution. An appropriate base temperature was required to do the calculation of heating degree days and cooling degree days. So a base temperature of 18 degrees and 24 for heating and 24 degrees for cooling was considered suitable for the Greek climate based on previous studies. And weather data in hourly format were obtained from a website that provides this type of files for building simulations. These are typical meteorological year files, and are they are constructed for building simulation properties purposes, and they are basically considered a typical meteorological year from a 20-year data set from weather stations. And another source of TMY weather data is also from the JRC TMY generator. Thank you. Where you can get the TMY file for a given longitude and latitude. So having constructed the heating and cooling distribution profiles, we were then able to proceed with the analysis. As mentioned, as we said, it was a district heating network that was where the heating and cooling was provided. So heating from the district, in order to account, we had the heating demand for the whole district from the red screen analysis, and we got the aggregate for the whole district. We had the hourly distribution profile of heating demand. So what was required then was to account for the losses of the district heating. And due to the fact that there was no available information from local district heating networks, we had to find that information from literature and from feedback from experts. So a value of 7% losses was considered appropriate and quite conservative, actually. So the heating demand was then increased by 7% to account that part of the heating losses of the district heating network, and the heating demand profile was ready made. So that was ready then. And the similar approach was followed for the cooling network. We had the cooling distribution, the hourly distribution for cooling demand. And then we had the cooling demand of the whole district. And then we had to account for the heating, for the losses of the district cooling network. And this was found to be 4% based on literature and the size of the network we considered. And therefore the cooling demand was then increased by 4%. So we defined the energy requirements, and then the next step was to define the energy supply systems. In this case, we used the energy was a 500 kilowatts PV system. Is a 5 kilowatts per house. So we consider installing a 5 kilowatts PV system on the roof of each house. And then again, we had to consider the hourly distribution profile of the PV system in order to get the temporal electricity production from the system. So the PV production, the hourly profile was developed with the formulas from the national directives on climatic conditions, and that method, these formulas considered the effect of solar radiation levels and panel temperatures. If that is too difficult to do for a simplified analysis, a simpler approximation method would be to assess the PV production in red screen and then create the distribution profile using the hourly solar irradiance data from the TMY file. Or alternatively, there are even ready-made PV and renewable energy and other renewable energy profiles that were developed within the framework of the Heat Roadmap Europe 4 project. And these are available for 14 EU countries. However, these are available for country level and not site specific level. So care should be taken there. Or even if there were, from some reason, if there's available data from an existing PV system, that would be, again, an easy way to develop this profile.
So in order to speed up a little bit the process, more or less the idea is that the structure we follow in the energy plan is the same with that of the red screen. So after having defined details about the demand side, we make more or less the same exercise for the power production and any storage solutions. In that case, it was the geothermal heat pump for heating and batteries for electricity. We have considered some, let's say, indicative values in terms of dimensions, able to support the half a day or even 2 days autonomy of the system. All these data are inserted within energy plan. And let's say the output of all this range of input data derive profiles on an hourly basis of the heating and cooling demands, the power production from different renewable resources, including as well the case of imports from available from existing grids. And to go on with the indicative results, except from technical evaluation, which can be depicted in the sense of some profiles and let's say time series on a day or on a month basis, not less discretization. These type of tools can also support the financial business models and provide input for that. Also providing values about the expected payback period, net present value, and IRR. Vasilis, if you can shortly present some indicative values to save some time.
Yeah, so we did the assessment of the zero energy scenario against the business as usual scenario for the whole district. The business as usual scenario has the buildings with constructed on an with the insulation according to building regulation. There is no energy production, and heating and cooling was provided by heating oil boilers and air conditioning units. While the zero energy scenario here is buildings with improved insulation. There's the PV, the district PV for 500 kilowatts, a battery with 1 day's autonomy, and the geothermal heat pump with the district heating and cooling network. And for these two cases, we calculate the heating and cooling requirements, electricity requirements, as well as the electricity production from the PV and the electricity exports and imports, and then the CO2 emissions and the costs for running and constructing these cases. If we move on to the next slide, please. Yeah, so we were able to calculate some basic the KPIs from the project, which is considered the degree of energetic self-supply, which is basically the ratio of the produced energy divided by the energy consumption for the thermal and electrical energy. So in this case, in the zero energy assessment, the zero energy scenario that we considered, all thermal energy is geothermal, so the degree of energetic self-supply was 100%. And then for the electricity, the locally produced energy is the production from the PV system. And what was consumed in the case was the energy consumed directly from the PV at the time it was produced. It was plus the energy that was the electricity that was stored and used later on by the district. And finally, the amount of electricity imported. And in order to convert that into primary energy terms, we multiplied the electricity imports by 2.9, which is the conversion factor for primary energy for the Greek electricity mix. And then this gave us the result of 100.4% of degree of energetic self-supply. So the criterion here was met in for both the thermal and electrical energy. And then the next KPI we used for the environmental analysis was the emissions reduction, which is basically the emissions of the positive energy scenario minus the emissions of the business as usual scenario, and that resulted in significant CO2 reduction as well. So we can move on the next slide. Thank you. And now for the financial evaluation, we considered the cost for the capital cost for the geothermal heat pumps, the district heating and cooling network, cost of the PV system and battery, as well as the conventional equipment uses in the business as usual scenario for the heating oil boilers and the AC units, as well as the electricity prices and the insulation cost. And we consider a project lifetime of 25 years and an annual energy price increase of 2% with a 0.5% annual performance reduction of the PV system. And that gave us a simple payback period of 14.7 years, a discounted payback period of 11.6 years. The net present value was positive, and the internal rate of return was 6%, higher than the 5%, which is usually considered for assessing such a potential investments. This gives us the indication that this is an investment which is both technically and financially feasible. And then we conducted this analysis for a parametric analysis by changing the insulation levels. So consider three different insulation levels, and then a different size for the PV system and different size for the storage, for the considering different autonomies for the district, and identified those configurations where these were technically and financially feasible. Thank you for me.
Well, thank you, Vasilis. All these type of simulations deal mainly with steady-state conditions, while, as you know from real-life conditions, one should include as well instabilities on the grid, and especially when someone has the integration of renewables and their injection into the grid, additional aspects should be considered. In that respect, SERF develops as well house-built models as that of Intema in order to investigate this type of instabilities and mitigation plans towards the design of these systems. We call this software Intema, and the added value is that compared to commercial products, it is an open access, so there is no any license fee, while someone can actually integrate all three main energy vectors on a common platform and examine different scenarios. This is intended mainly to support district level energy systems, including many different technologies. We are in position to model more or less every type of system, standard or even innovative ones. And the intention is also to support this type of replication activities to, in the sense to consider any instabilities, either on the mainly on the electricity grid network, especially when operates in a synergetic way with the heating or cooling ones. So I will give the floor to my colleague Makis Kataleris.
Hello everybody. I'll try to be brief. Intema, in fact, is not a single software, it's a framework because it contains quite many tools. The core of the Intema is the Intema library, which I developed in Modenka and includes energy production, consumption and storage models control components. In Intema, I also include some forecasting modules for energy demand production, demand response module, and optimal power flow modules. These the last three are developed in Python. What we can do with Intema, we can assess the electrical grid performance. We can examine solutions that offer ancillary services. We can estimate the response of the electrical grid, and these are what we call short-term simulations for specific technical challenges. But we can also do long-term simulations to evaluate and optimize seasonal, annual, and life cycle systems performance, such as power flow studies, And we can also identify rules and scenarios in energy management systems, and we can propose economic dispatch strategies. This is an example we have conducted in TEMA about it's similar with the previous examples that Vasilis present. It's about electrification of heating. On the left side, you can see the in TEMA main work space, the graphical representation of the system. As you can see, there is a district heating system, the whole district, some renewable energy sources, renewable energy system for production, and we have a boundary that communicates with the outer grid. What's the general idea? The general idea is to install a district heating system operating with heat pumps, and try to use the excess electricity from the renewable energy sources to heat, to provide heat to the district heating network. Okay, this is a more detailed slide. On the left, we can see the district in detail. There are lines, houses, loads, also some local renewable energy sources. And on the left, and on the right side, it's the district heating detail that also contains a solar heater for the district heating network, a storage tank, the heat pump, and of course a controller that the controller would decide when the system is going to operate. Of course, the system we have implemented some control strategies, for example, to operate when excess energy is available from the renewable energy sources. And but of course, if you don't have renewable energy sources, heat is a priority, so the heat pump will operate. For the heat pump, we have created a detailed model to estimate the coefficient of performances, and we have implemented this module inside the heat pump, the results of the model, in order to be fastest. Okay. Some results. We have on the left side, we have the simulation data for approximately 100 houses, as was the previous example. What is important here is that we have found that the excess electricity that goes to the network and the electricity for heat after electrification is lower. That means that we have to buy from the grid 70 megawatts. This is a nice result from the Intema, because you can see that these synergies have also some negative effects. We can see it in the next slide also, which is more detailed. Here are the various energy flows from the wind, from the PV production. We can see the power to grid line, but on the bottom there is some small times that we have to buy power from grid. This is why this is close to near zero energy systems and not zero, because sometimes we have to buy from the grid. This is what we have to optimize by using electrical batteries that we don't have in this case. Next.
So, my So in summary, we would say that the approach we followed is from bottom to top, considering the level of detail. So we started with the building level simulations, and then we use that as an input for the district level ones. We conducted several parametric analyses in order to investigate what is the best suited configuration to minimize as much as possible the financial aspects, mainly of the investment. So in these slides, you could see the final configuration, but the good thing with these tools is that they can support any parametric study in a simplified way. So if someone wants to go into more deep, of course, then we will need other type of tools, more detailed, like, for example, that of Intema. This type of tools that we implemented for the case of Iris project, we envision to do the same work for at least the Greek fellow city in positive, is that with, let's say, a series of input data in collaboration with the local municipalities, even non-experts can have a first estimate of expected impacts in terms of technical, economic, and environmental aspects through the use of this simple to use and user-friendly software. And through this type of tools, one can calculate the expected KPIs, which is, let's say, a requirement. And this type of results can be further used for tendering processes from the municipalities in order to transform the theoretical study into practical one. And in that respect, always the collaboration with the local municipality and local stakeholders, experts as well, is very important, at least for providing necessary input data that should be used. Okay, I'm not going into more details other than those. So I give the floor to Christian Keim from EDF to present, let's say, more commercial oriented viewpoint in terms of sizing of systems. So Christian, you may have the word.
You hear me?
Yes. Christian, okay. I will pick you a presenter.
Okay. Wait, the headphones. Yes. You want for me to charge, do you have it integrated in your PowerPoint? The presentation. Hello?
Sorry.
Do you have the PowerPoint integrated into my presentation to your PowerPoint? Maybe it's easy.
Yes.
Avoid to charge it up.
Okay, Nikos, does the
Yeah. For sure, Christian, Panos, make me the presenter.
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you, sorry.
That's okay.
So, I try to be really brief. I think we don't have much time. So, just to give you a small insight in how we used our softwares for this sizing of the battery of the building IMRED, which maybe you know. If you can go to the next slide, please. Nikos, can you go to the next slide, please? Yes, so can you push forward so everything appears? And exactly. So what we are talking about is the IMRED building. So for them who don't remember, it's one of the partners within IRIS. And they have a building, which actually the educational building, which will be delivered beginning of next year. And it's an individual self-consumption of PV. So the PV will be used to run whatever electrical system behind within the building. And what's interesting is that we have 175 kilowatt peak of PV. Then we get to the battery storage. You already have the result, but I'll give you how we get there. And then we have integrated also the fact that we have electrical vehicles within the building, and they will be charging at certain points within the premises of this building and also use the PV to recharge the batteries. Next slide, please. So we can go run through these three next slides, because actually it's just to show you that we use different type of input data. So we use the building load, which we had a half an hour level, and then we split down to a 10 minute level. And we also isolated the fact that we have electrical vehicles charging, and there might be possible to integrate that into the management of the battery in the forecast. And we have a PV production, which you see here. What you have maybe to get back home is that we have enough capacity to absorb the PV during usual working days. But as you see on the right side, in the weekends, we have huge amounts of surplus PV, which just has no use and just goes into the grid. So next slide, please. I don't go into details, otherwise we expose the time. Just to say you that we took information. We had to, so as you see, we had to on one side to know how we manage the battery. We have to know how much PV will be produced, and how much load we have on the other side, and how much we can control by the vehicle charging, by the battery, or by modeling the PV production. So we go quite into detail in how we assess the production side and reconstruct the historical data. And what is maybe important to say at this point is that we use this input data to train the forecast algorithm within the management system. So we integrate in the sizing the fact that we have a risk of or uncertainty in the forecast of the production and of the demand. So we already integrate in operational, as we were in real operation, the fact that we don't have some risks in this type of forecast. So we took satellite images and other type of information coming from the meteorological station in France on the site of the IMRED, and with that we get all the parameters and be able to reconstruct the whole reference scenario, let's say, for the PV. Next slide, please. And here, just to show you, we did the same with the load, which we had at a half an hour time. And as you might see, there's little movements in the graph in the upper graph, in which we have actually introduced a little bit of noise to just not be too static and let's say flat line of load, because it was very simplistic. And you see that also in the graph below, which you see that we have in the middle somewhere a huge moment which you have no load, which is mostly in the holiday times, because it's a university, so you have big periods of holidays in which you have no load, and so PV can just go into the grid. Next slide, please. So just to show you, the next slides will be to show you how increasingly we increase the scenarios of complexity for the management of the battery. And what I didn't say so far is that we integrated into the, let's say, evaluation, all economic and technical parameters of the battery, of the feed-in tariff, of the electrical tariffs of the building, the capex of the PV, the capex of the battery, same in the OPEX, so the operational expenses, and this will give us later the maximum. We integrated all this into the management of the battery and how they should operate. Here we have the reference scenario, so it's just the PV production and the load one with the other. We have no battery yet, and then we have our reference values, which will more time, I think, afterwards we'll have the presentation. We will be able to see in how far this reference value, so self-consumption rates, self-production rate, PV surplus, and the profitability evolve with different type of operational strategies. So this is our reference scenario. Can you move forward, please? And here we integrated just a simple strategy, which is to say, with the battery, we try to absorb as much as possible of solar energy and avoid to release as much as possible into the grid. As you see in the curve, they're pretty simple. I will just show you an attention in the right side of the graph. You see that the blue line has a huge peak and stops, and you have a huge surplus, which is in the upper lower part in red. It's the PV surplus, which will we never be able to absorb. So practically, by just doing self-consumption, you actually go almost until infinity the battery to absorb all the PV surplus. So it's, you have no real optimum for that. It's just how much budget you have as investment, which will decide where you stop your investment, the size of the battery, let's say. Next slide, please. So I don't want to go into the details of the graph. It's that to show we put different operations. So in this case, it's a tariff optimization and peak shaving, and how already this creates a lot of complexity into the operation of the battery and the management of the charging and discharging cycle. And so it's actually the most realistic way we would operate and use the battery when we go online. So move forward, please. So once we had these results, we actually did different sensibility analysis. So we run different scenarios, variating different aspects like the size of the battery, the feed-in tariff, or for the PV surplus, or some grid tariffs, to see how the whole business model reacts. So what we can say in our French case is the left side, what you see in the left side, is actually how the battery sizing is impacted by the grid tariff. So the fixed prices, so the subscription cost to the grid, which in France are very, very low. So the grid tariffing system in France actually doesn't give any reward in reducing subscribed power, so to make peak shaving, pure peak shaving. And this you see in the left side. On the right side, what you see is that actually these services, if you do peak shaving and peak shifting, and try to reduce as much the maximum output power, you never get really a working business model, let's say, out of it. Instead, if the input, the PV tariff is too high. So we always have kind of a negative business model for this type of approach. Next slide, please. So this is re-underlined in this graph. What you see here is basically saying you have the variation here is by the tariff for the feed-in tariff for the PV system. What it shows you is basically to have a working business model for a battery with a PV system, you shouldn't have any injection with today French type of regulation and economic, let's say, setup and parameters. So actually we have a almost positive net present value for a battery and a PV system in operation for 15 years in case we have no retribution for the PV surplus. Next slide, please. So we did a lot of analysis, and actually the choice at the end, to be really frank, wasn't a mathematical perfect type of choice. We really tried to focus on what could lead us to a battery sizing which was interesting for the building and less, not so let's say negative in terms of business model, overall business model, in the case we have NIMRED. So actually looked at, let's say, the inflection point where the rate, let's say the PV surplus that gets absorbed by the battery becomes flat by invested euro. So in the point where for each invested euro we have less absorbed PV, it's the point of research, and we found was about a battery of 100 kilowatt by 150 kilowatt hours. So it's a rather arbitrary choice, huh? But what is that we have taken as next slide, please. And then we look for the point on if we take now the battery and instead of just focusing on what you could do for the self-consumption as such, we look what we could do in case we to grid services. So grid services to the grid, so tertiary and primary services. And so to see if a service which includes the PV, a battery, and an operation system which is able to sell flexibility to the grid, how this whole together works. And what are the good news is that it seems in this case we have done it for the tertiary services. And you see we have taken different hypotheses of the availability of this type of service of the battery. And you see that the net present value, what you see in this graph on the left side, is this. In this case, you always have a net positive net present value for your case. So it means that once, if we just use the battery to absorb PV and work as a self-consumption optimization of the self-consumption mean, it's not really having an economical profit. Instead, if you now open it up and put some availability of this battery and service to the grid, you get possibly, potentially, to a positive business model. So next slide, please. And the same in this case for primary reserves. But we don't go into details, but the point here is that also with primary reserves, which actually is a frequency control reserves, you also have an increase of the net present value of the battery, but in a different way than tertiary services, because you operate completely differently your battery system. And so you don't get out as much as you would imagine, because primary reserve are actually the most valuable type of services. So I just give you different work we have done. And I think it was the last slide for me, yes. So it was just give you an insight of the work we have done and how we, the type of results we got by making simulation really down to, let's say, as we would it do it in a real case. And this gives us some insight in how we will have to operate the battery in a few months in the embedded building in Next City. So, well, that was for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Christian. And with this slide from our side, we are, let's say, finished concerning the presentation we prepared. So, should you have any questions, please feel free to make them. And thank you for your attention.
Maurits here. One question, if no one else has one. I was thinking about the dimensioning and the pricing of the PV and the storage, comparing the case in Alexandroupolis and now the Imred case. The pricing for storage has usually been the problem in the cases that we have had in Finland. And of course, it's quite dark here when we need the power. But anyway, we have had hard times getting a profitable model where we use storage for PV. But in the case in Alexandroupolis, it seemed to be quite easy to make a feasible model with storage. But again, in the Imred case, it seems to be a little bit more difficult. So where do you take the dimensioning and the pricing for the PV and the storage in Alexandroupolis for the simulation that you did?
So first of all, for sure, the context is a little bit different in the sense that the buildings in the case of Alexandroupolis are much smaller than that of Imred, and also they have a different profile. So Imred is a university, and as Christian said, it's not operable during summer. So this thing all changes the configuration of the whole system in terms of batteries. To answer more explicitly your question, Vasilis, do we have the values for the batteries that we assumed?
Yeah, I think it was around 400 euros per kilowatt hour. And this was taken as an estimation. So we had from previous project, we had some offers on different systems. To be fair, we had some quite different values there, and we took an average. So we had some quite more expensive than that, and something that was cheaper than that. So we took a basic average of that price. And it worked around as an average of these two prices. We consulted a few experts and we got this average price, let's say.
So for the case of Alexandroupolis, it was 400 euros per kilowatt hour, while for Christian, for the case of Imred.
I don't have the values for megawatt hour in my mind. I can search for it if you want to. But we took actually the real price we get from the tendering from the Imred. So we took actually the price it will cost to have the delivery of the battery as it will be done today, I think, in the Imred. But I can search for it if you need it.
Okay.
Yeah, we had quite diverse prices, so we took an average, basically.
So Maurits, the answer is that this is dependent first on the profiling, the typology of the building, and then the price that one assumes, which is deviating from country to country or from case to case.
Yeah, that was a good answer. And it will be interesting to compare and see. see how our cases add up.
Okay, thank you. Any other question?
No, I'm fine. Thank you, guys.
Okay, so that means that either we did a perfect.
I suppose the presentation will be uploaded on the MDesk, right?
Not on the MDesk. The presentation and the video will be uploaded on the Irish website.
All right.
Yes.
Thanks.
And in our YouTube channel.
Okay. Thank you.
One short question again from Maurits, if it's okay.
Yes.
Regarding the red screen software presentation, when you did the simulation for the buildings themselves, I think I maybe didn't really follow very closely. Did you do it for like one building and then added that or kind of counted that for all 100 buildings, or did you somehow do it for all 100 buildings at once? I was just thinking for the areas towards the south and the glazing and the windows and so on. So did you do it for one individual house or did you do it for all of the 100 at once?
No, we started for first of all, the red screen is oriented to the case of buildings. So you can see
okay. It was only
this slide. Mainly that we have started for at least the case 1.1, five different buildings. While we, of course, when we go on the level of the district, we aggregate this information from the building to the district level. So in the energy plan, which is oriented to the district level simulations, for sure we do not include the individual characteristics of each building, so 100 different buildings, but actually we select typologies and then we multiply the results with this representative typologies.
Okay, yeah, good.
Any other question?
It's Charlotte from Denmark here.
Mm-hmm.
I was just wondering if the presentation will also be available in the positive team. It will be uploaded there.
Yes. I will upload it also to the positive teams.
Super.
Thanks.
From my side, if it is to say, one key message is that for conducting replication activities, you can have many approaches, but from my point of view, whatever is done should be in the end end to some representative KPIs, and these KPIs should be technical, environmental, social, whatever. And to do this theoretical study, at least for the case of fellow cities, it is very important that first a very concrete ecosystem on each city is built. So you need to have the experts within this ecosystem who have, let's say, know-how of the situation, either in energy or in transport or whatever. This is very important in order to have the necessary input data for conducting whatever type of analysis one wants. So at least from our perspective, I would like to thank Alexandroupolis and especially Kostas for having this role. This is a key important role and it requires, as I said, almost day-to-day interaction in order to engage the local ecosystems to have the necessary data so that you can do the best that one can do for preparing replication activities, which in the end will lead to investments and achieve in the short term the goal of self-sustainable cities on a European level. the selection of tools is made upon criteria that one puts. In our case, we selected those that can be user-friendly, does not require very extensive know-how and deep know-how on the analysis of energy systems, because this is also a lesson for the local municipality people, who in most of the cases do not have the necessary expertise to go into many deep technical details. So you need to present them something that is as easy to understand as possible without many technical requirements. So this is one key lesson learned from this exercise. So unless you don't have any other question, I hope that it was useful, at least to give some insight of how we would deal that in IRIS and how we envision to do that, at least for positive, for the case of Ioannina municipality. And thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Nikos.